So I finally got a chance to play Halo Infinite, and as a longtime Halo fan from beginning of CE till now, I have some praises and also some concerns about Halo Infinite, and I want to provide those in this video, so stay tuned throughout the whole thing to understand all the details. Guys, this is absolutely crazy, but I got to play Halo Infinite. A game that I've been talking nearly daily about for 3 years has finally come. I finally had a chance to play it, and guys, it's fun. But this flight also has its own issues, so I wanted to cover everything from my first impressions of playing Halo Infinite. So if you guys kind of like these commentary type of videos, make sure you tap that like button. Let me know you want to see some more content like this. If you want to stay up to date with everything going on with Halo as we ramp up to the release of Halo Infinite, make sure you tap subscribe. Let's get right into the content here. So first of all, I actually forgot to record gameplay while I was playing last night. I was on my stream, which we do stream every Tuesday and Thursday night, guys. It's a great chance to jump in and play with the community. Link in the description of this video. So I actually ripped these gameplay bits from my live stream. So I apologize if the quality isn't that great. So for this video, I want to start macro and just give you my overarching opinions. And then as we progress through the video, we'll go into more and more detailed items throughout the whole thing. So macro, what is my first impression of playing Halo Infinite? Well, first of all, we only played against bots. So we didn't get like the true experience of playing against players and their habits, but you know, these bots, they're pretty good. Not some pushovers that just walk into a wall, essentially, but we'll get into that a little bit later. My overarching impression of Halo Infinite is that it's good. To me, it feels kind of like an updated version of Halo 3 because we have sprint, clamber, slide, and those kind of abilities, but the gameplay itself and the map design so far from when we played on live fire feels very Halo 3-esque. Putting a huge emphasis on the sandbox, obviously the addition of equipment from Halo 3 has that same feel as well. Like, it really does feel like if Halo 3 was made in 2021 instead of 2007, this is kind of like how I had expected to play. The sound design is phenomenal, the gun gameplay is really fun. There are some weapons that are a little weak, we'll get into that a little bit later. But overall, first impressions, this is really good. I could totally see myself sticking with this game if the first initial gameplay experience is like this throughout the rest of the flight and coming flights as well. I think we got something really special on our hands as a Halo fan. So this next section, we're going to go into more detailed elements of this fight so we can give a true experience of how this plays and my thoughts on it, because this is a first impressions kind of video. The first thing we need to talk about is sprint. I know some people are not happy about sprint being back in Halo, but at this point, guys, sprint has been in Halo longer than it hasn't been in Halo. So I think you're kind of beating a dead horse and making a losing argument that if you're trying to make the case that there shouldn't be sprint in Halo. The thing is that with sprint in Halo Infinite, it's very different from what we have from Halo 4 and from Halo 5. As overall, the speed of sprint doesn't really feel that much greater than just normal walking speed. Normal walking speed has definitely been increased in this game. From my 3 hours of playtime, I never felt like I was moving slow when not sprinting. And sprinting doesn't really give you that much of a speed boost while playing. We did this test on my live stream where in the back of the map live fire where that base is, in the center platform area, went from the wall to the steps. And I just walked that distance. It took me about 4 seconds. Sprinting that distance took me about 3.5 seconds. This isn't like an exact science. It's just kind of like in the moment how we kind of measured it out. So there definitely is a speed boost when it comes to sprinting, but it's not as great as you would expect. But sprinting seems to be more detrimental than positive to the gameplay. We'll get into that a little bit later. But you can recharge your shields while sprinting in this game. That's one thing I'm a little concerned about, because you could do that in Halo Reach. You could also do that in Halo 4. And that led to a lot of really annoying situations for those games. Now, could Halo Infinite play different? Absolutely. I never really came across a situation where I felt like the bot was like running away from me where I feel like I would have had the kill. First time we're playing against bots, playing against actual players, this might be actually become an issue. We'll have to keep an eye on that one. I'm more of a fan of Halo 5 sprint, where if you took damage, your shields wouldn't recharge and it took you out of the sprint animation. You can also reload while sprinting now as well, which that one I'm kind of for. I like that feature. Now, the reason why I said I was going to touch on it a little bit later about how detrimental sprint can be within Halo is because of the radar. We have a brand new radar system. It's very similar to, say, the HCS ranked radar from Halo 5, where it tracks your abilities rather than your movement. So you no longer have to crouch walk to stay off the radar. You can just walk normal speed. You will not show up on the radar. You only show up on the radar while sprinting or shooting. Personally, I really like this change. This helps speed up the gameplay a lot. It allows for flanking maneuvers to be a much more prevalent in Halo Infinite as well, so you don't have to crouch walk and play super slow. And overall, I really like this new radar system. I really hope they stick with it within the release of Halo Infinite, but obviously that thing can be subject to change as well. We'll just have to keep an eye on that. And a big reason why this game felt like Halo 3 is because equipment is back. We had the chance to play with the drop wall on live fire, and the drop wall seems to work out very well where it comes to being able to provide a one-way shield, which is really cool, kind of like the old plasma shield that we had back in Halo 3. But there are some very interesting counters. You can shoot at that drop wall and it will break off segments that don't really take up that much damage. I think it's like a 2-round burst of a battle rifle will take out one segment of the shield, which is a huge gameplay element that really helps balance the whole thing out. And if you shoot the bottom pedestal thing that's holding up the whole thing, it takes out the entire shield. So there's really great ways to counter this equipment while also having to be very advantageous to the player who uses it, which is perfect classic Halo sandbox mechanics. It's absolutely amazing. I do love how all the equipment and weapons have a place where they spawn. You see a little indicator on the map where they will spawn. They also show an indicator of how long it takes for that item to spawn up as well. There were multiple times when I was playing, I looked down the floor, I see the indicator that the blue line has almost reached its full capacity. So I'm like, oh, just wait 5 seconds and get some equipment. That's really great information to know. I'm talking about pickups, let's talk about the weapons. I think this AR sidekick combo that we've had for Halo Infinite is probably the most balanced and fair starting setup we've ever had within a Halo game. The MA40 shreds at close range, and even if you tap fire, you might be able to extend the range out a little bit. But the sidekick as well, it kind of plays like a Halo 2 pistol, but way more effective and actually useful. Where I found the best strategy was to use the AR to kind of shred shields and then swap to the sidekick to be able to get that headshot. The sidekick is really interesting because the red reticle range and aim assist is super low as well. This is definitely not like your Halo 5 Magnum or anything like that. This is definitely meant to be a close range, finish off the character kind of weapon, but it helps extend your range a little bit to get like that singular headshot. But both weapons for starting are super effective, but obviously if you pick up a weapon off the racks, it's actually more advantageous as well. So it has a great spot where you can still be effective if you don't pick up a weapon, but if you pick up a weapon from one of the racks, it definitely will help make your gameplay better. I do love that the precision weapons are projectile, like the battle rifle. You had to lead your shots, very similar to like Halo 2. So it's a very quick projectile, but you still have to lead your shots in some capacity, which I'm all for. This makes larger scale modes like BTB way more playable. Now for the power weapons we had to play around with, we had the sniper rifle, skewer, and the heat wave. The heat wave to me feels a little underpowered. I would like to see it be a little bit more deadly because it is a power weapon, but the description of it does say it's like a forerunner shotgun, an ability to extend the range with the vertical shot ability, which this gun looks and shoots amazingly. Like when I shoot a weapon, it feels like fireworks are going off, the ricocheting off the walls. It just looks so cool. The skewer against players is actually very difficult to hit shots on. I was like struggling to hit these bots who were maybe even just standing still for the most part. Very low aim assist, not that easy to use. I think this skewer is going to be much more against anti-vehicle kind of stuff rather than anti-personnel, which is going to be great. And also the sniper rifle plays like the sniper rifle. You have to lead your shots a little bit, kind of like in Halo 3 and Halo 2. And so I'm all for that. Now let's talk about the bots. These bots are the easiest level bots, marine level bots. And honestly, they're not chumps. Like we were playing in a party of four and we were stomping them like 50 to 15 every time. But there were some moments where I was like, dang, that bot like actually outplayed me on marine difficulty. The grenade placements are amazing. These guys know exactly how to throw grenades. These bots throw grenades better than your casual players. So I'm a little intimidated to play the rest of the flight throughout this weekend because the bot difficulty is going to be bumped up each day. So I'm a little afraid against playing against Spartan bots. Where if you're playing Halo Infinite and if you get called a bot, I think that actually might be a compliment nowadays. Now I also want to talk about the map Livefire that I've got a chance to play on. This felt like a classic 4v4 arena style map. This also kind of ties into what I was talking about with Sprint as well, where Sprint might actually be more detrimental in your 4v4 arena maps. One reason it's more detrimental to Sprint on these 4v4 maps, at least if it's going to be following this format, which it looks like it will for live fire, is that one is that you show up on the radar while sprinting so people will know your location, and two, you don't really need the sprint to get into the action. I found myself kind of more sprinting to get into the action from spawn. Once I'm in the action, I'm not sprinting at all. I'm actually just kind of casually walking around looking for bad guys to shoot. So even though Livefire plays a bit smaller than your Halo 5 maps, but because of movement and also the abilities have been toned down within this game, that it feels much more of a classic style map design with Sprint, but Sprint not breaking the map, it feels like so far. So we talked enough about the multiplayer. Let's talk about the other feature within this flight, the Academy. This is going to be a great spot to get a chance to play around with the weapons and also some interesting little detailed mechanics when it comes to playing Halo. I played around with some of the weapon drills, and it's a great way to get acclimated with some of the different weapons and some of the more familiar weapons that have different changes and features to them. I've been seeing a lot of people online posting like, oh, I got this high score with the sniper rifle, like 52k, 1000 points. If you can beat me kind of stuff. So that's a kind of a fun community aspect of the whole thing. And the music, guys, oh my god, the music for this game is absolutely incredible. It sounds new, refreshing, yet familiar at the same time. It's so good. There was a segment where the main theme of Halo Infinite started playing and I just sat there vibing. I didn't want to hit play. Oh, listen to those drums, boys. Oh, listen to this. Oh, vibe with me, chat. Oh, this is so good. Like, I don't want to hit play. I just want to listen. Dude, listen, this is so good. It's Halo, man. Normally I turn off menu music, but this is menu music though. Now I brought this up in a previous video, guys, talking about mouse magnetism. That's an option to play with mouse and keyboard. Now I played this with the controller and mouse and keyboard. Overall aim assist in this game does feel pretty low. Obviously, aim assist is a huge advantage for controllers within the gameplay of Halo, so we wanted to test out and see, did they give aim assist to mouse and keyboard? Because it states in the description that it gets a little bit of an aim assist when it comes to playing on mouse and keyboard, and when I played with it, I wasn't really noticing it. If it was there, it was very slight. Mouse and keyboard only player active was also talking about this, saying that it's so minimal about the mouse magnetism that it's not even really noticeable within the gameplay. When I first turned it on, I felt like I noticed it, but it could have just been just user error. I also got a chance to play around with the ping system, which is a really great feature, and it also didn't really seem like we were utilizing it a whole lot since it's just a new feature. It's kind of tough to do on controller as well. I actually mapped it to one of my paddles utilizing the custom options when it comes to mapping your keys and buttons on the controller, which is such a great feature to have within this game. It does seem to be a bit of a cooldown with it as well, so you won't be seeing people spamming pings all throughout the game. I didn't really dive too much into the customization or battle pass because I was just so focused on the gameplay, but we were getting some new levels on the battle pass. I think I played for about 2 hours or so, about maybe like an hour and a half worth of actual game time, and we were able to progress a few levels through the battle pass out of the 30 levels I believe that they're there, or 20 or something like that. The customization looks like Reach customization, which is awesome. I like that a lot. Now my biggest issue with this entire flight process, guys, was Halo Waypoint. Many people were not able to play this flight because of Halo Waypoint or the pending issue that was happening on Xbox. And I knew this was going to happen. Like, having this many people funnel into Halo Waypoint, the website is not designed to have that much traffic on it. It's going to run slow, it's going to be crashing, and it's going to be causing a lot of headache, which exactly that's what it did. I don't know why, like for me as a Steam player, I had to go to the website to grab my Steam key, then download it. That's all I needed. This is just the key. So why couldn't that just be emailed? I believe with the early MCC flights, we were getting our keys emailed to us individually, so we did not have to go to the website, which was the really great feature. So I didn't have to spend so much time just refreshing my page. I sat there for 2 hours trying to refresh the page and log into my profile so that I can grab my Steam key. Unless there's like a legitimate security reason why these keys were not sent through email, I can't believe that they actually did that with having to force everyone, hundreds of thousands of people wanting to play Halo Infinite. You force everyone to the website will crash, it will cause a lot of headache. So for these future flights, can we please just have these keys emailed to us to ease off the load and extra work that 343 has to do so we can all focus on just playing the game and having fun? Like, that was just so incredibly frustrating trying to get a Halo Waypoint. But those are my thoughts on Halo Infinite. Yeah, guys, have your own thoughts? Leave them in the comment section down below. If you're new to the channel or missing any content from me recently, check out the videos right here. I got a link to a playlist that has all my Halo news and informational videos right there. So thank you so much for watching. I greatly appreciate it. I'll catch you on the next one. Peace out.